Hello and a warm welcome to another edition of To The Point. On the show this week, Director General CRPF Rajiv Rai Bhatnagar. I welcome you on the program.
Thank you.
So CRPF has a long history of valor, and we also have seen that the force always keeps up the professionalism to its maximum, without forgetting, of course, the sacrifices of the soldiers. So post Pulwama attack, how are you really concentrating this task?
See, CRPF has a glorious tradition of both valor and sacrifice. Starting from the hot springs against the Chinese, then the Sardar post against the Pakistani army, the different insurgencies, be it Punjab or be it Tripura, the different attacks, the attacks on parliament or the attack on Ram Janmabhoomi. There have been various instances where the force has come good in the internal security arena. The Pulwama attack in JNK has put up a new threat, and we would need to set up systems so that the threat of a car-borne fidayin assailant can be countered. So we are working on that. There have been different kind of threats which have come at different stages, and we have been able to counter most of them, and we have been very successfully working in JNK in coordination with the other agencies.
But when you say that you see a new kind of threat post Pulwama, so what is the exact pattern you are hinting at? Is it in terms of the fidayin attack or the module which was followed by the militants? What is the exact indication?
See, it is the fidayin attack. We have had fidayin attacks on our camps, but that was a different kind of a, you know, modus operandi. This time, it is an attack with a vehicle-borne fidayin. The vehicle was laden with explosives.
Okay.
So this would require different kinds of countermeasures, because this could be used on the road. It could be used also against a camp to ram into the camp, the gates of the camp. So, and it could also have variants that it could be used with motorcycles, it could be used with personnel. So there are different aspects that we need to look into so that we could build our modalities against this kind of a threat.
But the way this attack happened, as you yourself are mentioning, that it could have ramifications in other manifestations as well. So since it has happened in JNK, which of course is a very sensitive area, but can you say in any capacity that it could have an impact in other parts? Maybe the terrorists can use the same model in other parts of the country as well?
You see, once a threat has been identified, we would need to work on it in other places too.
Okay. Okay. There was a tweet post the Pulwama attack from the CRPF that we will not forget and we will not forgive. Are we to understand that in the coming days, the anti-terror operations will intensify? Of course, we've seen some of the militants have been killed. But are we going to see a further intensification of the anti-terror operations?
See, last 2 years, there have been multiple successes. Most of the Tanzeems have suffered heavy damage. Their commanders have been neutralized. And the operations, the in-based operations in conjunction with all the agencies are going on, as you have seen, that we have had a very successful operation against the Jaish,
right,
and two of their very important commanders have been neutralized. So this will go on.
We heard that this attack has, of course, been the deadliest so far in the history of Kashmir. So would you say that from your experience and the way CRPF has been conducting itself, has this been the deadliest attack in terms of the casualties?
See, it is a attack in which the losses have been severe.
Okay.
And if we were to look at the past few years, we would find that in terms of the kind of threats that had developed, we had quite a few attacks, fidayin attacks on our camps, which we had, you know, effectively countered. And also we had built up our defenses so that in the last year we have not had any attack on our camps.
Right.
Then the question of, the threat keeps changing. In between we had the threat of snipers,
right,
which were trying to pick out our sentries and people who are on duty at different places and hitting them. We have also managed to neutralize the modules which were responsible for that. There were also a lot of incidents of grenade throwing which were taking place. So there also, there have been a lot of successes. So now that this new threat has come, all the agencies are working on it, and I'm sure we would be able to neutralize these modules.
But now when you look back to the incident which happened on 14 February, do you think that there were, in terms of the standard operating procedures, were there any lapses? How would you look at the whole incident?
You see, we have been, if you were to look at attack on convoys, then there have been quite a number of attacks in the past.
Right.
But if you were to look at nearly the last 2 years, we have, in view of the earlier attacks in 2016, 15 and even earlier, we had made a lot of changes in the way that we were running the convoys, in the kind of protection that we were providing on the convoys. And therefore, we were able to successfully run the convoys without any loss for the last almost 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
So our SOPs are working and they are effective, and the IED checking is also going on. Like I said, that this is a new kind of a threat which needs to be now factored into our SOPs.
Mm-hmm. But we also saw that the civilian vehicles were allowed with a convoy, and there were about 2,500 Jawans in traveling in that convoy. So now when you look back and after so much of introspection, was it a good idea to allow the civilians to move along with the convoy? How did that happen?
See, civilian traffic has been allowed with the convoys for a very long time now, maybe almost more than a decade today.
Right.
So it was not a question of whether we allowed it or not.
Okay.
It is a fact that you have to accept that the civilian traffic does move with it.
Mm-hmm.
So now that this kind of a threat has come, we are working out modalities so that we could make sure that at least we do not come across civilian vehicles as far as possible.
Right. But why I ask this question, sir, was that when we know that there are so many Jawans traveling in a convoy, then maybe we could have...
No, if you were to look at the convoy, like today also, the convoy started in the morning.
Right.
The BSF convoy was there and our convoy was there. They left Jammu at 3:30 in the morning.
Okay.
But there was a landslide. So they have not even reached halfway till now, all day. So now we are asking the army to, keep us somewhere for the night because we don't have the camps and routine. So, these are runtime routine things that have been happening all the time.
Right.
The convoys have always been run. And then we also have to understand that it is not just from Jammu to Srinagar that the convoy runs. From Srinagar or from other places, our men are always going on duty, our officers are always traveling. So the question of stopping traffic everywhere in the state, we go on duty every day.
But what kind of an emergence do you really see when you talk about the improvised explosive devices? Because there was a statement from the former army chief Bikram Singh who said that it looks like a totally new pattern and we see a return of the IEDs in Kashmir. So
IEDs were not much used. Again, they were in 2018. We saw about 9 instances of IEDs being used. Before that, IEDs were not being much used in the JNK theatre.
Right.
And in that, only in one, there were casualties where three JK police personnel were martyred, where it was deployed and the explosion took place in a marketplace.
Right.
For all the others, it was the vehicles which were targeted, but there were only injuries.
Mm-hmm.
And they were vehicles which had enough protection to withstand. And then these were small IEDs. They were nothing compared to the IED that was used in this particular case.
Okay. CRPF paramilitary forces have been associated with tackling the terror activities in Kashmir for a very long time. But what we have seen is that there is a spurt in the terror-related activities, especially when you look at the Pulwama region and the affected parts. What according to you is the major reason? Why
that is not really the correct assessment of the situation. Okay. If you were to see that most of the Tanzim have suffered very serious losses in the last couple of years. The security forces certainly have the upper hand. And if you were to look at also the law and order situation, the number of stone pelting incidents, those and the intensity has also come down. So all the forces have good control over that area. This is of course an incident in which the losses have been very heavy. But if you look at the long string of successes that the security forces have, so security forces definitely have the upper hand.
If you look at the whole narrative which is being spun around the Pulwama attack, there are many people who are saying that there is a re-emergence of Jaish, and Jaish is re-emerging, though in the last few years we've seen a number of their commanders have been killed. So would it be right to assess that Jaish is on the upswing, and how would you really look
at it? No, I don't think one can come to any such conclusions. The Jaish has suffered very heavy losses in J&K.
Right.
And you saw that immediately also two of its major commanders were killed. So that is not correct. It is a one-off incident.
Okay.
That they have also done attacks on security forces in the past also. But definitely their numbers have come down in the last year.
Mr. Bhatnagar, tightening the leash on Jaish, but at the same time you also have terror outfits like Lashkar-e-Toyba, Hizbul Mujahideen. What is going to be your strategy in tackling other terror outfits?
See, there are different Tanzeems, like you said, which are operating there. They have foreign terrorists who infiltrate from Pakistan with the active support of the establishment there. Then there are local recruits. There are some misguided youths who get radicalized and join these Tanzeems. So action has to be taken against on both the fronts. And there is good intelligence being generated. There is very good synergy between all the security forces. And therefore there have been a lot of successful operations. Of course, even a recruitment in the last few months has substantially decreased.
Okay.
So, the government is working on all aspects so that recruitment is less, the infiltration from Pakistan is less, and also we are effective in getting good intelligence on which operations can be based.
Right. You just now said that, of course, local recruits is also a challenge. Of course, the number has come down, you know, with the way the misguided youths have been radicalized. But how serious is this problem when you talk about pockets like Pulwama? I mean, there are certain pockets where you do find homegrown militants. So how serious is the threat, you know, as far as the security?
South Kashmir is the most infested as of now. And in the other areas, the numbers are less. And also, successes have been actually across the board.
Right.
Even in South Kashmir, the security forces have had a lot of successes.
Right.
So overall, like I said, the security forces definitely have the upper hand.
Right. We also saw 2 days ago that the government has said that there's a tactical shift, that those who want to surrender will be rehabilitated, will be accommodated, but those who pick up the guns will be eliminated. So we'd like to understand from you that what is this tactical shift? What is this new thing which has come up, that those who pick up the guns will be eliminated?
See, it is very clear that we would like the people to give up the militancy.
Right.
If a local youth has joined terrorism and if he is prepared to lay down his arms and surrender, then we would encourage him to do so. But however, if he persists on, you know, still being a terrorist and carrying out anti-national activities, then he would certainly be neutralized.
But there has been a surrender policy earlier as well. So how is this going to be different from what we had earlier seen.
So there are very, very nuances, and there is a very difference in approach and the intensity. As you would have seen in many of these operations, even injured persons have been pulled out and given medical treatment. Once the cordon is laid and the terrorist is isolated, the J&K police is still giving him an opportunity to surrender.
Right.
So it depends on the kind of modalities that are being deployed.
Right.
And also the kind of effort that is going into that. So, you know, contacting the parents, also looking at the youth who are missing.
Right.
If we could contact their families and get them to communicate to the youth that you should come back, join the mainstream and surrender. So an all-out effort is being made.
Right. So do you have special campaigns or programs where you actually reach out to the families on a regular basis, whichever?
See, it is being done by all the agencies, like okay. I said, by the JK police especially, mm-hmm. because they have the local connect okay. to approach the families, to look at the youths who are missing and try and get them back into the mainstream.
Okay. We've often seen that, you know, attacks like Pulwama, when they happen and, you know, Pakistan goes in a denial mode. But what happens to the morale of the Jawans? How do you keep it sustaining? Because so many lives killed, and so keeping the morale, keeping the Jawans in their most utmost high spirits does become a challenge.
See, it is a loss. Certainly, it's a loss for us. And I salute the brave martyrs. We are a professional force, a very battle-hardened force, and we will take up this challenge also. The loss has made our resolve even stronger, and our force is very professional. They understand the situation. They know that whatever may be the challenge, they will be up to it, and they have a very glorious record of doing the same. We are the highest decorated force, so we are very proud of our officers and men who are prepared to take up every challenge, and our morale is very high, and such losses even make our resolve stronger.
Coming to the anti-Naxal operations, CRPF has gained a significant success in bringing down the Naxal operations. Despite all the successes, where do you think that the forces need to work more? And maybe you treat it as a challenge as far as the Naxal terror is concerned.
You see, Naxalism, if you were to look at the left-wing extremism, the
right.
Baoists today, their areas of influence have shrunk a lot. The
right.
security forces have pushed them back. The number of Maoists who have been neutralized, their number has last year was very high. And if you were to compare with the number of personnel of the security forces which were martyred, there has been a sea change. It was before 2014 that more security personnel used to get martyred than the Naxals, the Maoists who were neutralized. But this time the figure is reversed. It's almost three times the number of Maoists have been. And also development has gone into those areas. The areas where the influence of the Maoists have decreased, development has come in. Roads are being built. Connectivity is being done.
Right.
And the public is also getting disillusioned with them. The government is filling up the administrative and the security vacuum. So the general public is also realizing, and also in areas where they were strong, where they had a lot of support, they are also realizing that this is not in their interest.
Right.
The Maoists are not actually interested in the welfare of the inhabitants there, but are trying to perpetuate an ideology. So it has made a lot of difference.
Right.
And still, the challenge remains in certain pockets, like in South Bastar or the Mard area,
right.
or in certain areas of Jharkhand and Odisha. There is very good coordination between all the state police forces and the central forces that are working on this count. You would have seen recently in the elections which were conducted at Chhattisgarh,
right,
in spite of the boycott call given by the Maoist, still there was nearly 76% polling. So a lot of progress has been made on the left-wing extremist front.
One last question before we wind up the interview. Whether it's the Naxal areas or its terrains like J&K, another very big menace which is evolving is, you know, the impact of the fake news and the way it spreads on social media. So how do you really tackle it, and how what kind of an impact does it have on the security forces in the way they deal with these kind of things?
See, all agencies are alert regarding fake news,
right,
and there is an effort which is sometimes very well planned,
mm-hmm,
to try and embarrass the security forces with so-called human rights violations and try to set them back. We monitor it, the other agencies also monitor it, and we also counter it by telling what are the facts, what is correct, what is the truth.
Okay.
And we are also collaborating with all the agencies, the local police, the district administration. So we are able to confront these fake news, and we are able to tell the public the facts so that public opinion is not, you know, unnecessarily against us.
Right.
And you would be happy to note that in the last year, there have been hardly any human rights violation accusations against the CRPF.
Thank you so much and wish you all the best, sir.
Thank you so much.
So that's it on this episode of To The Point. See you next time with another personality. Goodbye and thanks for watching.